Sai ki jai, Bhakti Devi ki jai, Tulsi Devi ki jai, Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tatho Jaya Mudirae. Nashta Praeshu Abhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke. Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki. So we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 8, entitled The Story of Pingala, Text 20. Please repeat after me. Indriyani Jayantyasu. Nirahara Manishina. Varjayitva Turasanam. Tannirannasya Vardhate. Indriyani Jayantyasa. Nirahara Manishina. Varjayitva Turasanam. Tanninasya Vartate. Indriyani Jayantyashu. Nirahara Manishina. Varjayitva Turasanam. Tannirannasya Vardhate. Indriyani Jayantyasu. Manishina. Vajaitva Turasanam. Tannirannasya Vardhate. Indriyani Jayantyasu. Tanniranasya Vardhate. Indriyani Jayantyasu. Vyahara Manishina. Vajaitva Turasanam. Tanniranasya Vardhate. Mataji. Indriyani Jayantyasu. Nirahara Manishinaha. Varjayitva Turasanam. Tannarannasya Vardhate. Indriyani Jayantyasu. Nirahara Manishinaha. Varjayitva Turasanam. Tanninannasya Vardhate. Indriyani, the material senses. Jayanti, they conquer. Ashu, quickly. Nirahara, those who restrain the senses from their objects. Manishina, the learned. Varjayitva, except for. Tu, however. Rasanam, the tongue, tat, its desire, niranasya, for one who is fasting, vardhate, increases. Translation and purport by the humble disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: by fasting, learned men quickly bring all the senses except the tongue under control, because by abstaining from eating, such men are afflicted with an increased desire to gratify the sense of taste. Purport: in South America, there is a saying that when the belly is full, the heart is content. Thus, one who is eating sumptuously is jolly, and one who is deprived of proper food, one's appetite becomes even more voracious. An intelligent person, however, does not fall under the control of the tongue, but rather tries to make progress in Krishna consciousness by accepting the remnants of food offered to the Lord, prasadam. One gradually purifies the heart and automatically becomes simple and austere. In this connection, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur states that the business of the tongue is to gratify itself with the varieties of flavor. But by wandering in the 12 holy forests of Rajmandal, Vrindavan, one can be freed from the 12 flavors of material sense gratification. The 5 principal divisions of material relationships are neutral admiration, servitude, friendship, parental affection, and conjugal love. The 7 subordinate features of material relationships are material humor, astonishment, chivalry, compassion, anger, dread, and ghastliness. Originally, these 12 rasas or flavors of relationships are exchanged between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the living entity in the spiritual world, and by wandering in the 12 forests of Vrindavan, one can re-spiritualize the 12 flavors of personal existence. Thus, one will become a liberated soul free from all material desires. If one artificially tries to give up sense gratification, especially that of the tongue, the attempt will be a failure, and in fact, one's desire for sense gratification will increase as a result of artificial deprivation. Only by experiencing real spiritual pleasure in relationship with Krishna can one give up material desires. Om Ajnantamirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gurun Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsa Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Ragunathan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Pada Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Pancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prastaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschata Deshatarine Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadha, Shiva Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So in 1966, as we all know, Srila Prabhupada took that memorable historical visit to go to the USA to follow his spiritual master's instructions, which was given to him on more than one occasion, but the last was in 1935, December, on the banks of Radhakund, just a month before His Divine Grace Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur had left this world. So Srila Prabhupada meditated on that for 30 years, planned for it, and then left. We know that. And within 6 months, actually when he went there in 1965, the first year was very difficult, but he stuck to his task. He just went out, you know, chanting under tree, meeting whoever came to his classes, he would talk to them. But it was only 1 year later that some of the initial devotees who became serious started coming in. And then 6 months later, the first devotees who actually met him in New York, especially Mukund Maharaj, now that time he was Michael Grant, and so when he got, he was the one who actually helped find that the 22nd Avenue storefront. So when he moved to San Francisco with his wife, and on the way they collected some of their friends and excited them also. Those friends had not even met Srila Prabhupada. The friends were Sam and Melanie, who are now Shyam Sundar Prabhu and Malati Mataji. So they went to San Francisco. And just imagine that how fired up they must have been, that without even seeing Prabhupada, and that too we have to put the cultural context of 1966-67, which was at the peak of the anti-culture movement, where they never wanted any, it was defined by defiance to anybody over 30. And here was a 70-year-old man, and of course these people had not even, these young boys and girls had not even met, at least the ones in San Francisco. But just by hearing a few tapes of his, and directly here, seeing the change that they could see, even in those first few months, in Mukund Maharaj and his then wife Janki, they got excited. And Shyam Sundar Prabhu, without meeting his spiritual master, future spiritual master, he started planning for, because that was his creative flavor, and he started planning for this a big bash, big event. And I think many of us have heard him here recently when he launched his book just a few months ago, when he talked about, he read the passages also, and he gives a very detailed description of the incredible event, the Avalon ballroom. So I wanted to start by mentioning this because we have read in the Satsarup Maharaj's books, which is really the biography of Prabhupada, about how he went to San Francisco first time. First of all, this was the first flight Prabhupada ever took in his life, because he went by ship to US, then he went by bus to Boston, and then by bus and car to New York. So this is the first flight he took, which is almost 6 hours, and so he tolerated all that. He came to San Francisco from east to the west. For many of us who have not gone to USA, you should understand how big it is, that India and Calcutta have one time zone. If it is 8 o'clock now, or 9 o'clock, 8 o'clock now, it will be 8 o'clock in Calcutta. And the US is so large that there are four time zones. So New York and San Francisco, that's about 4 hours behind, because you know the sun comes much earlier in the east, and the one cities in the west they put their clocks 4 hours behind. So with all the time zones, so it is such a very different world. Prabhupada goes there, and then this Avalon ballroom. It is very difficult to describe unless we read. Actually, it is really worthwhile reading about this in Chasing the Rhinos with the Swami, a book by Shamsundar Prabhu. But what he says is that they didn't know whether it will be a success. They were, first of all, he had not met him, so he was wondering whether if it's a big flop, people may not come also. So they had put all the posters all over, and it was all in the hippie world. Hippies were the ones who were completely revolting against, you know, so not bathing for weeks, deliberately having long hair, most of them into drugs, counterculture. So it was really a defiance to what was there. So what would they accept? It was just like, do what you feel like, you know, speak what you want, you know, everything was in that natural way. But as it turned out, 5,000 people were present there. And it was not only that Prabhupada's was the last act. They had somehow been able to, with their dynamism, mobilize a huge number of bands, some very famous bands. Some of the names were the Grateful Dead. Imagine. So it just gives an idea of what was the grateful to be dead spiritually, as Radhananda mentioned once. But they were very famous. So because of that, people came. And of course, they had such a heart that they were willing to help others. They all came for free. Practically most of them didn't charge anything, just so that people could, I mean, their own brethren could actually benefit. So they come there, and it's completely packed, and it is, to say it's noisy would be an understatement, because you know it is it was so loud, and the strobe lights were all over and pulsating, and absolutely, like, it was to say it was a mode of passion also would be a very poor description. Anyway, and then this was started from some 8 in the night, and Prabhupada came in towards midnight. He was brought in only that time. So you can imagine that in 4 hours, you know, people were, some of them were less clothed, some were not clothed. It's a fact. I mean, it was like that kind of a culture, that, and it was not that people didn't bother. It was just, that was the mood, that we didn't, they never really, these things were passe, they were completely incidental. That was the mood. Here is a Swami from, you know, Vrindavan, Radha Damodar Mandir, you know, such a strict Swami, never been to the West, that comes there, but just to promote Krishna consciousness and see his understanding of the whole underlying sensitivities, and also, but going through all that, cutting through that, and seeing the simplicity of the people there, that he came through, and when he walked in, he had never been there, of course, never seen such a situation. And when he walked in, 5,000 people, suddenly there was a kind of a hush as he kept walking. People parted, he went up there. And then in that mood, there was, he led the kirtan, he spoke a little bit, but he understood that this was not the mood for kind of lectures. So he spoke briefly, but then he started the kirtan, devotees were dancing, so everybody just caught on, and the kirtan just picked up like wildfire. And then after maybe half an hour, 1 hour, he left. So in fact, even at that time, Shyamsundar Prabhu says it was very controversial, because within the few devotees of ISKCON, because the devotees on the East Coast in New York, who had now spent 6 months with Prabhupada and had Swamiji, as they called him, and they had actually grasped the essence, they're trying to live a very regulated life, trying their best. Some of them actually had moved into the temple, a couple of them had shaved up, initiations had taken place. So they were, you know, following the four regulated principles and so on. And then when they heard about this before the event took place, they were very upset about it. So they were saying that what are they doing to Swamiji, you know, he's at this age here. So because they knew what it was, because they were there till a few months before. So they understood it inside out. So in spite of being caught, so he took a big risk, Shyamsundar Prabhu. Nevertheless, it was a big hit, because devotees, people got exposed, and it really became very popular. It became a defining moment in the, it gained a lot of credibility and respectability in the youth of USA. In spite of their not being, or maybe because they were not so much in favor of the establishment and all, but when they saw Swamiji, they could sense that the genuineness. Of course, not many may have accepted or understood also the philosophy, but some of them did. And Radhanath Maharaj was talking recently, just recently mentioned that he met a devotee now, that is, this was in 1967 January, and we are now in 2018, 51 years ago. So he met a devotee who had just, he was actually part of those 5,000 people, and who met Prabhupada, saw him for the first time, and he was on the other side. That means he was one of those hippies who were dancing and everything. And now today he's, you know, as a shikha, kantimala, neck beads, I mean tilak, chanting 16 rounds, a full devotee 51 years later. So we underestimate the power, that time and also even now, when we underestimate the power of not just Prabhupada's presence and his sincerity, but the simplicity of the message. Because when even it was also credit to these the hippies, it's many of them who started coming regularly to the temple, that as Prabhupada said later, that why he succeeded in the West first, because he said, I went with a blank slate. They came to him with a blank slate. Just like a child has a slate, you know, you write with the chalk. So you may have written earlier some things which you have been taught, but when you want to really learn, you rub it off and you come with a blank slate. So he said, they came to me with a blank slate. That means they were completely open to accept and understand. And while it took time for sorry, for them to really grasp and implement the philosophy, but they stuck on, you know, they stuck on, and that was because there was a chemistry which was between the eventual spiritual master and them. Why? Because Prabhupada could see through all the other external inconveniences and you know, aberrations. He could see that there was a genuine heart, and it was a very simple, they were simple people basically. You know, even when they were opposing things, there was no duplicity in it. I mean, that is the way they understood. They were tired of too much materialism, and then they opposed it. So, on the other hand, here, the devotees also, those who took it, they saw Prabhupada as a genuine person who wished well for them. So, the message that came through in this very historic Avalon Ball was that being simple and being sincere was a very critical need. And this is what Prabhupada stressed all through his message, all through the 12 years that he spent. And also when he was quoting various scriptures constantly, the examples he gave, this message was an underlying theme all the time, that simplicity of heart. Simplicity does not mean, see, sometimes our understanding of simplicity, way we may have come through our you know, the academic backgrounds and so on, and somehow we think simplicity means being a fool, simplicity means being less intelligent, simplicity means unsophisticated, not worldly wise, etc. While actually simplicity means in real sense, simplicity is actually the highest intelligence. Because those were very simple. Sukhdev Maharaj was very simple. People were joking about him. People were laughing at him. But he never bothered. Jarbharat was didn't speak. He was so intelligent. He knew, okay, if he spoke, then he might become proud. So he kept quiet, and he just accepted all the insults and the scorn and the, you know, condemnation of everyone around him. So they were very simple because they stuck to the message. Then they understood that they needed to just project. And Prabhupada kept that in the forefront. He said that, and those who really succeeded also were ones who actually did not take pride into thinking that they were the doers. Because that was a message Prabhupada said, that we are only instruments, we are only instruments, we are only instruments. Just do, have faith in your spiritual master, and follow the process as sincerely as you can, and whatever the whatever you do, whatever you think, whoever you are, I mean, if you keep thinking about your own positions now, like even in spiritual world, as you in ISKCON also, as you may grow in stature or you may grow in responsibilities, you may become a temple president, or you're in big in some project. So people then, from their innocence, the other devotees also will start respecting you more, thinking that, oh, he's a dynamic leader. And that may be true, but then we are all human, and then we start feeling pride. Somebody's given large donations, so people will say that, oh, that is. So you start having kind of mentally a hierarchy within ISKCON. Is Vaishnava philosophy means there's no hierarchy. We are all the same. That is the basic principle. But it starts subconsciously building, because we are used to thinking like that. So you may then have different systems of hierarchies. It could be based on whom you think. Okay, so you may have substituted the material world heroes by spiritual world heroes. But nevertheless, considering that, if someone is a very eloquent speaker, you know, he's rated very high, somebody who's seen to be always around Guru Maharaj, will consider very high. That is actually external, and if you start judging by that, not only we may be creating offenses, but actually it could be very much wrong, because there are so many, I mean, we've seen in Prabhupada's time also, there are so many devotees have served him over 51 years now, and some devotees have not even met him, and most of the devotees hardly met him for a couple of times, or two, three times, most of the devotees. And today they are so fixed, because they understood that Prabhupada was present everywhere. If you accepted Prabhupada from your heart and accepted him as the link to Krishna, then he's always with you. Like Prabhupada would say when he went to the West, that I was never a moment without my spirit. I never felt even for one moment. 30 years later he went to the West after his spiritual master departed. But he said, I never for a moment felt that my spiritual master was not there. And when he was giving classes and on Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's appearance there also, and they had the celebration, Prabhupada was weeping, you know, when he was remembering him. So therefore he was feeling such a strong presence. So this is what we can learn, that we cut through all the complications that we might create. So if we have services, if we have things to do, means we have responsibilities which we have to, but we have to constantly see that it is. If we get successes in that, and if people acknowledge that, we have to be grounded to understand that Krishna is the doer, Krishna is recognizing and pushing me, and I need that help. But we need to see our own weaknesses. And this is what Paramahansas do. If you see that the difference is really, in the material world, we have a competition to see who's better. You know, generally, we tend to broadcast and recognize our own. First we recognize and then we broadcast our own good qualities. I mean, we are men, particularly in the occupational side, you know, we are taught that you can't be very, very, keeping it under the table. You know, we have done so, you have to bring it out and you have to present it well, and you have to make sure that the people who count, they have to know that it is. So that becomes second nature. Everything is natural, that we have to project ourselves, that I am, you know, I've done this, I've done that, I've done better than him. So we are competing for attention, and we are broadcasting our own glories. And then that rubs out into us, into various areas of our life. While in the spirit, in a devotional atmosphere, they are competing. And especially if you see the genuine devotees who are really inspiring us, Prabhupada and then his disciples, and then this current generation of devotees, second generation, third generation of devotees who are there. We look around and we are here for many years. And then there may be devotees who are very educated, very talented, very capable, organizationally or whatever they can bring. But that is incidental. They are happy to do it in the service, but they continue doing the services in a very humble way. So that there's a competition to see who's actually more humble than the rest. So this is the essence of our movement, that Krishna consciousness is the awakening of the dormant desire to serve, which is there in everyone. But in doing that, we recognize that our own, that we are still a very infinitesimal part of Krishna, and that we are trying to, so no matter what events unfold, we may go through big successes, we may go through drops in, we may have problems, challenges, but the steadiness, continuity is really what we see. So the Paramahamsas are ones who always constantly look inside, even though they have no failure. Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami, or all these glorious, Rupa Goswami, all the great followers of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they were constantly critical about themselves, looking internally and feeling that they were nobody. It was not that they were lacking in self-esteem. It's just that they only saw Krishna and in such a the perfection that in their presence they honestly, genuinely felt that they were nothing. So while we cannot be on that level, but that is what we need to see in others, and that most important is that in this Krishna consciousness movement, what we hear, what we know, we don't get value for that. What we implement and how we link it to our behavior is critical. So actually, the meaning for association of devotees, the meaning for Bhagavatam, reading scriptures, chanting arounds, all these, the sadhana process is actually meant for seeing how we can adapt from that to our life. So we may spend a lot of time, reading a huge amount of literature and memorize many shlokas. We have so many huge amount of we have a lot of understanding. We can give excellent classes. We can have people wrapped in attention hearing us. That could be very. It's not that it is. It's wonderful, but that by itself will not really take us, because the secret, as Srila Prabhupada told us, is that we can only make progress by invoking the mercy of the Vaishnavas and the Lord only. So there is no other way. So it is not by our action, but if our action pleases devotees in a genuine way, and again when there's a sincerity of purpose, then we, with the mercy, we are able to progress. So the progress is only by invoking that mercy. So that mercy will come Prabhupada has already clearly said, and Krishna also says, so many times, Krishna, why do we keep the gopis as the highest pedestal? Because of their simplicity. We have the wonderful story of the Brahmins and the Brahmin Patnis, when Krishna and his cowherd boys were playing around, and then Krishna and Balram were hungry, so they sent these boys and said that these Brahmins were there nearby, these were studying scriptures. So go and ask them for some prasad, some food. So they went there. So when these young cowherd boys went there, so the Brahmins, who were very respected people, they had so much of knowledge. They understood all the details, intricacies of the Vedanta, and then the etiquettes and the pujas and so on. But they were, when they looked at these cowherd boys, they had become so arrogant that they felt that, we know so much, we are so busy, we are doing so many things, why bother? These people are just, these young cowherds, what do they understand? They just come to bother us, so they just brush them off. So they miss the whole point. It's like, what do they say? They're missing the wood for the trees. So they were so short-sighted, they didn't understand the whole purpose was actually to please Krishna. But that's what happens if we have such traits that we get missed out. But then when they went back to Krishna and Balram and said that, this is what the Brahmins told us, they said, okay, go and talk to the wives who were nearby. Now these, the wives were so simple, and they had, but they instantly, spontaneously wanted to please Krishna and Balram, so they immediately arranged for it. So actually they got the highest blessings. Eventually they saw Krishna, and they saw his glories. They got his darshan. They went to the pastures of Krishna, of Vrindavan. So why is that? We also come to Radha Gopinath temple, we go to Radha Rasbihari temple, hundreds of people come every day. But do we see Krishna? Do we actually see? It's very difficult actually, because the Krishna, we are seeing the form, we admire the dress, we admire the jewelry and the cleanliness, but what do we actually see? So Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, actually Thakur has said that we should not try to see Krishna, because that will be very difficult, that will be impossible, but try to serve in such a way that it pleases Krishna and his devotees, and then Krishna will reveal himself. So Krishna will reveal himself when he, according to our consciousness. So that's how the mercy comes to us. So basically it is a process where we just continuously, steadily do our whatever work is, whatever happens. The thing is that we, every day is a different day. The events will unfold, you know, none of us could have projected what happened, say, 6 months ago or a year ago in our life, or 5 years ago or 10 years ago on any event. All of that was something which just happened. There's no predictability. Similarly, nobody would know what happens tomorrow, months later, years later. So many things will change. But so while it is not easy, but being in the association of devotees, and this is what Prabhupada said many times in his purport. He said, the purpose of the temple is to provide association so that in the association, the devotees can actually take, understand the message, means they hear the transcendental message, they see the examples of devotees. You know, they see devotees around them who are actually making progress, who are living examples, who are living their lives in there. And then when you come to know in association over time, you come to know internal issues about so many devotees, so many families, and you're constantly struck and wonder that how is it that this particular devotee or this Prabhuji or this Mataji, how are they able to, if I were in the position, I couldn't even chant, I can't even remain in Krishna consciousness. It's, you know, many times we feel that how is it that someone is struggling against odds? But those struggles will not always remain, because you will, things keep changing. And dualities of life, Bhagavad Gita, Krishna starts, says in the beginning only, that these dualities are these appearances, like the appearance and disappearance of the winter and summer seasons. So it comes and goes. But then to implement in a life means somehow we have to remain steady. We go through disappointments, we go through problems, and of course we are conditioned, so we are not going to be, it's not smooth sailing. You know, we will be feeling real pain when we are not supposed, we may be hearing that, we hear Prahlad Maharaj's story and we hear Dhruva Maharaj's story and we hear so many stories, where they, but of course they are pure devotees, but they are meant to tell us that if we try to follow that, eventually, and we have survived all those. So if you think of a crisis, and everyone must have gone through some crisis or the other in what ways, and at that time, just try and meditate for a few moments what we were thinking at that time. We may have been thinking that, you know, this thing is so bleak and I don't know what I'll do and what will happen. And now we are here, we say that it wasn't as bad. I mean, somehow we have, you know, Krishna will take care. So that way our faith starts increasing. Because the process of Krishna consciousness is a process which starts with a little faith, adho shraddha, tata sadhu sangha. You know, little faith will then bring us to devotees, the association, and then, you know, gradually the anarthas start, if you are sincere, then they start removing. So it's a process, and we cannot hasten the process. We cannot, as I said in the purport, you know, we cannot artificially try to do something which we cannot. We also have to recognize that, you know, it's a Krishna consciousness, a natural process. So let's try to be natural in what we can do. Natural doesn't mean that we are transcendental to everything. No. Natural just means that we recognize our limitations and we try to, within that, not try to project what we are not, not try to do what we are not. You know, we may see the hear the philosophy, see devotees, and in our enthusiasm or somehow we are trying to act, maybe not deliberately, but we try to act like what we are not. And it is such a mental strain that we are not going to be able to survive that in Krishna consciousness, spiritually. And then we will, because then suddenly we feel that, well, this is how I'm supposed to be looking, this is how I'm supposed to be acting, this is how I'm supposed to be doing, and then I'm doing this. We cannot carry it long. So it's like a, you know, it's like a drama, but you cannot carry it on forever. And then eventually we can't accept the, you know, disappointments and perhaps the revelation that we are not up to where we are. So the natural process is that we don't accept our weaknesses, certainly. We try to work on it. But we recognize that they're there. And we just follow the process. And gradually, depending on our sincerity or purpose, we will be able to come out of it. So I wanted to read this. There's a very nice, in Queen Kunti's prayers, one of the verses which purports what Prabhupada mentions. This is in this is 1.8.20. Chapter 8 contains the Queen Kunti's prayers. So in this purport, Prabhupada mentions, even the greatest philosophical speculators cannot have access to the region of the Lord. It is said in the Upanishads that the supreme truth, the absolute personality of Godhead, is beyond the range of the thinking power of the greatest philosopher. He is unknowable by great learning or by the greatest brain. He is knowable only by one who has his mercy. Others may go on thinking about him for years together, yet he is unknowable. This very fact is corroborated by the queen, that is Queen Kunti, who is playing the part of an innocent woman. Now, Queen Kunti has just been, in her prayers, has just been, you know, saying that while she has been, she is such a glorious devotee, and also happened to be the mother of the king of the whole world, Yudhishthira Maharaj. This is after the coronation of King Yudhishthira, after the war is over. And yet she is saying that, you know, among other things, she says that, my lord, you know, as you know, women are not very philosophically inclined, and you know, therefore, I don't know so many devotees are. I mean, there's so many philosophers and so many great personalities. They know so much about shastras, and we would not know anything. So, she's, you know, kind of highlighting her, as if she is this unqualified. As we were talking earlier, that you know, great paramahansas, they talk about their weakness, even if it doesn't exist, they will, they're made that way, that they will always look, they somehow see that they're inadequate. So he says that others may, Prabhupada says he's unknowable, Krishna is unknowable. This very fact is corroborated by the queen, who's playing the part of an innocent woman. Women in general are unable to speculate like philosophers, but they are blessed by the Lord because they believe at once in the superiority and almightiness of the Lord and thus offer obeisances without reservation. The Lord is so kind that life that he does not show special favor only to one who is a great philosopher. He knows the sincerity of purpose. For this reason only, women generally assemble in great number in any sort of religious function. In every country and in every sect of religion, it appears that the women are more interested than the men. This simplicity of acceptance of the Lord's authority is more effective than showy, insincere religious fervor. So, you know, among other things, what Prabhupada mentions, and he's quoting Queen Kunti's prayers. Queen Kunti also goes on to mention that how actually, if you go to see that Prabhupada translated Bhagavad Gita, then teachings of Lord Chaitanya, and then he translated the Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita. And the queen, prayers, there are so many wonderful prayers, dozens and dozens of prayers, you know, Brahma's prayers and you know, Prahlad Maharaj's prayers, wonderful prayers. Why is it that the book has come out, teachings of Queen Kunti? Prabhupada did it with a purpose. There is a series of lectures that he Prabhupada gave only on that, which then became a book. It's a whole book only, it's just a part of Bhagavatam in the first canto, chapter 8, because he knew that this is most topical for us, particularly in the Kali Yuga, and because this is how it is misunderstood. So, Queen Kunti, among other things, also says that how the Lord is specially favorable to those who are materially impoverished. It does not have anything to do with whether you have money or not. It's basically if somebody who has simplicity of heart and somebody who is not caught up by the, what she says, you know, the four major problems that everyone means, which could, it is actually not seen as a problem, but, you know, high parentage, high birth, high parentage, high learning, strength and wealth. So those who are actually blessed with these four, Queen Kunti says that actually it is a burden. And because, why is it a burden? Because that induces us to feel that we are something, that we are something special, we are you know, we have done something. So we forget that we have been born into it, maybe because of our karma, there is some purpose. Whatever reason we have come, we have no idea. Nobody has any idea why we were born in a particular circumstance, why we have been given a particular set of brain cells and an environment, why certain so-called fortunate events take place in our life. So many things that happen, it's just beyond anybody's thinking. But illusion is such that it makes us feel that we are the doers, and that is what Maya makes us feel, that you know, we are the ones. So we just naturally slip into that role and assume that that intelligence is mine, that the wealth is mine, the strength is mine, good looks is mine, and then we actually start working on the bodily level. So the actually brings us closer to the concept of attachment to the body, while we are actually trying to understand the on the level of the spirit, that saying that we are not the body, and whole life we're struggling to understand that what does my spirit soul need, and what are these natural needs, and how does the spirit soul reconnect to Krishna. Instead of that, this takes us, so this is where the challenge really takes place. And she says that, Prabhupada says in the in elaboration, some other purport, that this he has mentioned many times, that Krishna consciousness means simple living and high thinking, while actually material life means very dull thinking and very high way of living. So it's just the opposite. No. Because what happens then, the more we have, see, that's another illusion, that the illusion tells us that the more we have, the less we'll need. But actually it's the opposite. The more we have, the more we need. Because it then, when we have something already, our whole life, our whole concentration, becomes a huge strain to just maintain that, or to increase that, or to protect it, or to see that it doesn't get affected. And then our thinking, you know, diverts into what others are doing, and then somebody else is doing better than I, somebody else is getting more marks than I, somebody else is increasing more wealth than I. So many, everything then becomes on a competitive level, which is taking us purely on a ego trip, because then we are thinking that it is I the doer, which is actually not the case. You know, we have just been kind of planted into some house and some events take place, and we are just you know, foolishly thinking it is that, and then soon we are going to go out of this world. You know, so if somebody is looking from Mars and looking, you know, it looks so foolish that someone comes in, forgets instantly that where he or she comes from, goes through, and then just assumes like a robber, you know, that he's that everything is his. And then the foolish person eventually is ejected out of this world at the time of death, whether it's 50 years or 80 years, but it's gone. So the process, you know, in a whole universal way, is virtually like a moment. So, you know, just like we may look at some insects which come for 8 or 10 hours and go, and we may say that what kind of a living entity that must be. I'm sure there are many others who must be watching and seeing that these foolish people, they come, they just assume who they are not, and then they go out. So for us to understand that from their perspective, this is where connection with the scriptures and devotees, and living, seeing examples of others, the steadiness that they bring in, so that it goes against the grain to strain. See, the whole consciousness is continuously focused on trying to preserve and to maintain. And then we work so hard just to, so precious hours that we have, but constantly, you know, be only diverted towards that. And then actually, and especially I've seen this, when people who have really achieved a lot of success, but then when the time comes, eventually at 60 or 65 or 67, whatever age they retire, if they have got so used to some successful occupation, it's a shock, you know, that for them, because they got used to recognition. They've also got used to a certain comfort of, you know, dealing with what they are familiar with and what they really are expert at. And then suddenly it comes to a shock, and then they are nobody. And then, you know, it's very difficult. And then even the activities are only related to that. So that that concept of work is worship, which was coined by somebody who was an agnostic, is absolutely, you know, it's ridiculous, because work is not worship, but actually Krishna is worship. Work is only part of the way you can reach Krishna. So, we are talking of simplicity. This very nice story of Jagannadas Babaji Maharaj, who was about almost in our line of in this line of our acharyas, one of the he was the one who actually gave the sanction, you can say, to Bhaktivinoda Thakur, that Mayapur was on the other side of the Ganges. And while everyone was thinking that it was being worshipped on the wrong place, not Mayapur, I'm sorry, both place of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So by that time he was only 120 years old. He was being carried also in a basket. So that this is the time when he was being carried by a servant, Bihari Das. So once one rich person gave 1 rupee, which was a very large amount 200 years ago, to Bihari Das, just, you know, because they were going on a very long journey. So, and the Bihari Das was carrying the basket in which Jagannadas Babaji Maharaj was there. So they had gone a long distance, and then Jagannadas Babaji Maharaj asked his servant that, did you get something from this rich merchant? So he said, yes, he gave me 1 rupee. So he told him, no, let's go all the way back, go and give it back to him. So they walked all the way back and gave that 1 rupee, he made him give 1 rupee back. So the merchant was saying that, why, you know, you keep it and you'll need it, etc. So Babaji Maharaj said that, no, as it is, he already has a burden of carrying me. This is an added burden. You know, so he meant that it's a mental weight. It's a burden of mental weight which we do not want to keep. So he was very clear that, no, that even the 1 rupee I don't want. Prabhupada also gave a very nice example of this Kali Yuga, you know, how it traps us. You know, when we're talking about, you know, if we are born in a high family, when we're a high family, we start thinking that when you say, okay, we have maybe an aristocratic lineage or a background which is of that, which induces, I know, among the very high learning, high society, etc. Or if we are given with a already blessed with a lot of wealth. So we get trapped, and he compared it with a prison. So he said that Maya, that is illusion, actually is so intelligent, far, far more intelligent than we, that she has created this world where it is a prison without bars. Because generally when you go to a prison, you think, you only go to prison when you are a criminal and then you are locked in and then you have the bars and there is a locked door, you cannot get out. In this case, there is no external closure. There's everything is open. Like, we can go out of the door, go outside, walk anywhere, go to Chowpatty, go wherever, go in the train. So we feel we're free. But while we're alive in this world, it's like someone when tells us that if you're in prison, someone says he opens the door of the prison and says, "Now, chalo, get out." And then the person says, no, I'm busy breaking rocks. I don't want to come, you know, I've got work to do. So you think he's crazy. He's getting a chance to get out. So similarly, Krishna, Prabhupada would say that Krishna is coming himself, or he sends his representatives to tell us that this whole Durga, which is the prison here, saying, why don't you come out? Come to the spiritual world, and this is the process. And we are saying, no, we're very busy. So he gave a very nice example to explain that if we try to see that, so it doesn't mean that we see, we have to understand that you have to make the best of a bad bargain. So we have come here because we have chosen to not to be with Krishna. So Krishna has created this material world for us. But now he wants us back more than what we want to go. So he's, and when we get a chance like this, which is not understood, how we have come in contact with a spiritual world in this world, we should grab it, and not under no circumstances we should let the process stop, no matter what happens externally. Tomorrow if our business fails, or if our family, there's some major issues, health issues, so many things may happen. There's nothing which will be even an iota of, can stand as much as, you know, the kind of gain that we've got. The gain is so huge of just getting in touch with this that it would be most foolish that we would want to leave it. And we have to see that it is Krishna's test for us. Because Krishna creates all this only so that we are, it's like how gold is really refined, and you can differentiate between gold and brass when you really put it to test. So it's, if you really have some metal, if you have some substance, Krishna wants to see that whether we voluntarily want to come to Him. So the tests are there. And then for us, when we look at tests, Queen Kunti is one, but we have also so many tests, so many people who have gone through, everybody goes through tests. And when we see how people face that test and resolutely determined to at least follow the process no matter what, it's incredible. Then that is, we have to take this very gratefully that those examples are meant for us. There's another story in the one lady meets Krishna, and she's carrying a huge burden, and on such a it was so heavy, and her shoulders were paining a lot. So she's carrying on the left shoulder. So when Krishna meets her and tells, you know, that you want any benediction? Can I help you? So she says, yes. My only benediction is that can you move this weight to my right shoulder, because my left is paining. Instead of saying that, why don't you take away my burden? Krishna was right there. So, you know, we may laugh at it, but actually if you go to see, Duryodhan saw Krishna. Duryodhan saw the Virat troop also. Right? I mean, not only Duryodhan, so many millions of people saw Krishna. But we say, we may look and say that they saw Krishna. How can it be? I can't believe that, you know, how could they not recognize Krishna? You know, he is so... But that's the whole thing, that we come to Radha Gopinath. So somebody will come and tell that, you know, you are coming to Radha Gopinath, but you never saw. So unless we follow the process, Krishna will not reveal. So actually, he's there. You know, for instance, we are constantly told that Krishna is present in his holy name. But we take this as a phrase. But actually, when we are told that Krishna dances on our tongue when we chant his name, do we take it really seriously that actually it is the case? And for somebody who takes it very seriously and actually concentrates and really puts his heart into chanting, will make progress because of his faith. So really Krishna is there everywhere. Krishna is there in other devotees' hearts, and he's coming through. So the signals are there. The, you know, manifestations may be in so many different ways. The scriptures are there. The examples are there. Even those who are creating problems for us, the way we think, Krishna is in their heart. So there is a purpose for what Krishna wants us to do. So that it's not that everything is deliberate. Krishna is doing it with a purpose. Nothing is happening by accident. So incidents that happen to us, events that happen to us, it's a question of how we react. Radhanath Maharaj also mentioned, His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj mentioned in his book, if you read The Journey Home, about when he had just come to India and he had hardly anything. He was in the Himalayas and he was practically no possessions, but he had a big bag of books, and he was really feeling that he needed all those books. And once that the whole bag was stolen, he just put it down for a moment, and somehow even looked back at somebody had taken it. And initially he was quite upset that, you know, I needed those books and all. But then he realized that actually I'm feeling so light. You know, I was carrying all this so heavily. So he made that very interesting, very amazing realization then, that actually one doesn't need anything. The reality is that you can stay without anything. All you need is the holy names of Krishna. That was the time when it actually dawned really on him that this bag was actually had become a burden. But he couldn't feel that, he felt, I need this, I need that. So it happens to us also, even on this mundane issues that someday I'll need this, someday I'll need that, someday I'll need this, and we keep getting attached to the possessions. We just can't let go. So the more we try to accumulate, the more we are actually accumulating anxieties in our mind. So this accumulation tendency is actually, we don't see it. We're looking in that shape and form of that object, but actually it's eventually become, because all that we have to give away later on. So it becomes an anxiety. And Krishna reveals himself, you know, through to us by to the extent that we are turning towards him rather than to the other attachments. Also, the story of Maharaj Chitraketu, where he a great personality, but you know, he got he was so attached to his son, and that led to so much misery eventually. But he realized it later. So he had everything. So this also gives us, we can learn from this that, you know, a person like that, he had everything means everything. You know, he had all the attributes of a near perfection in virtually all attributes. But there was only one thing was lacking. So that's what really kind of, you know, that pushes us, because how mind goes only to that one thing. If you have 99 things, we take it for granted. But that one thing that is not there, it's just constant. Like, I want that, I want that, I want that. Gaur Gopal Prabhu gives this very nice example that, you know, when we are chewing something and then we finish eating, and then, you know, one small morsel gets stuck in a tooth somewhere at the back. So the tongue will not rest till you keep on and on trying to get it out. So, you know, it's our mind is like that. You know, we will just, everything, the focus is only on that. That till it gets out, you know, you are restless. So it is the nature of our thing that we concentrate only on those things which we don't have, disregarding ungratefully so much that we have. If we can actually just understand this, and especially when we have challenges, and then we count our blessings, how much we are grateful for, really it is... it completely changes the way we see things. You know, it's like glass half full, half empty. We're looking at very pessimistically, and then when we look at it with hope, because we see things that we have so much that if I was to have this problem, at least I got this problem where I could have had this problem without the association of devotees, without coming to the temple, without having any kind of understanding of spiritual life. Now this problem was destined to come. I was born, whatever age, Krishna decided that at such and such time in my life, I'm going to have these problems. But that problem has come at a time when now I'm able to see, and he's given me so much of armaments, so much of strength. So if we look around and he said that, just imagine if that same problem had happened, which otherwise would have seeming insurmountable. I could have become a terrorist. You know, sometimes a person, you know, out of hatred, you know, we read in the paper someone does some crazy things, but do we know that it's so unfortunate that he must have or she must have gone through such hell and misery, must have seen a childhood, you know, so many abuses, so many things, and this just comes out, erupts, you know, they hit society. We could have been like that. So if our problem was to come, who is it that has protected us and given it at a time when we have all these armaments around us? Imagine if we have got all these, you know, in a war, and if you have got the highest armaments, then we have the protection. But we don't look at it. We just want that I'm missing this one AK-47 or this missile. I just need that. But you have got missiles with you, you know. So Radhanath Maharaj would say that just do the needful, do your seva. Why make distinctions between success and failure, honor and dishonor? It's a very wonderful statement that he makes. Why do you make distinctions between honor and dishonor? Thing is that we get elated when we are honored or we are happy, and we are deflated like a balloon, just pricked, you know, when we have got some problems. So we go, you know, we are really letting ourselves swinging with the wind. You know, we just go lurching here, lurching there. That's the way a life would go through. But when we actually, it's more difficult to be equipoised when we are happy, because then we just let go, because it's like we are, you know, starving for some good news. Something happens and we just, what happens is it takes us to such a level temporarily, thinking that that's the end of the world and it's all temporary. And then when it comes down, we are completely down in the dumps. And then so I remember when I was in childhood, I think most of us go through it, you know, we just at count, you know, Fridays were best because Saturday, Sundays after that, or April is the best because May, June holidays are there, you know. And then school starting, you know, God, Monday morning means 5 days to go. So you tend to think, okay, when are those happy days coming? So we try to look at that. Now here, yes, that natural feeling is there. But if we were to understand from the point of view that we are going to have challenges, We'll also have happy moments. We should be happy all the time, of course, but it's not, we are going to be disappointed. If we lose a loved one, if we have some losses, sometimes stock market losses, sometimes, you know, our fights in the family with the neighbor, you know, some health issue comes up, some crisis comes up. This is going to be, and we are going to, but if we are in touch with devotees and examples and reality and scriptures, we will really have a balance rather than comparing and saying that this person looks so happy because he's wearing this tie, or this lady is so happy because she's using this perfume. We are not foolish to think that the happiness comes only by, you know, just looking at someone's smile on a billboard. You know, that's what, so it is a foolish, anyone can say that, you know, that's, it's only meant for us to take that item, but it's not signifying that we are actually going to be happy. So happiness will really mean when we genuinely go back to our touch and where we are, when we are in the mood of service. So sacrifice is a critical element. Sacrifice, you know, if you see in the material world, the word sacrifice is never used. Never, you never use. In fact, if at all is used, it's considered a very derogatory thing, that why is somebody losing out, you know, why is somebody giving up something that he is entitled to? We are kind of forced to, because it becomes a selfish endeavor that I must do for myself. And while here, if we have to, if we try to understand from Krishna's point of view that we are all living entities, then no distinctions will be there, you know, caste, creed, class, education, whatever. So one in that level, you know, we will then we can only see it in the from the way we are meant to see it, and that's how we could then serve Krishna. So whatever situation we are in, we should never take it at face value. That means means whatever the implications of that challenge or the crisis, we try to evaluate our situation based only on what will happen to me tomorrow, today, day after, you know, because this bad news has come or this disturbing news has come, and we get unsettled. So we are only looking at it at face value rather than going to the depth. So an intelligent person is one who really goes into the depth, into understanding what is the that yes, I have to, there are two levels. One level is that I'm seeing, this is a reality. I have a challenge, I have a problem, I have to deal with it. You know, my son is not, you know, he has two complete different views, and he just, suddenly now he says that, I don't want to stay with you, for example. It may be very big problem for us or something. And then, so while we deal with it, but if we were to deal with, you know, we just lose our control and completely act only on the basis of that face value, then we may actually regret many actions because we're doing it with no knowledge. But if you have been given the fortune of understanding where we are, then you may sometimes temporarily use words or do actions, perhaps, which we may regret, but at least then we understand that it was a mistake and we rectify. But hopefully we may also be able to not even have those problems or not even react in that way, because we can see it in two levels, that one is the face value and the other is that I have to act in whatever I do, but I am not attached to what happens. You know, it may change, it may not change, but I do my best. I will see it in a larger context. So this is where the difference would be, you know, while we are in touch with the spiritual world, the Vaishnava way. And Prabhupada made this, with the purport that we read about what Prabhupada said, that women are, in that sense he said women are superior. Radharan Maharaj just commented in another lecture, he said women are superior to men because in that sense they are, they have that implicit faith, they have the understanding. So when we go back to our discussion earlier about simplicity, so we have to change the way we look at things. See, we have also get so conditioned and brainwashed that we look at, we respect intelligence in what way? We think intelligence is someone who's got 99.9% in the 10th standard, or someone who has started a business and become very, very rich, or someone has made some discovery. Right? We're looking at an academic, never mind if the person is an agnostic and he says he doesn't believe, you know, he may have a brilliant mind. But if he doesn't recognize that knowledge, remembrance and forgetfulness comes from Krishna and he's acting on our level. So from the spiritual level, the person is foolish because he's wasted his intelligence. Similarly, someone has been given huge wealth. Someone is now $90 billion net worth or $10 billion, this so much crores or rupees, etc. And he may or she may choose not to because they are trying to preserve it, or they may promote causes which support indirectly and directly themselves or the way they see the world. So we may, it is unfortunate. So therefore, you know, the way we the way we look at things, we tend to think that we respect such things rather than actually understanding that focusing on the basic, that is Krishna, is there is a Supreme Personality who's in who has made this supreme order, and I have to find my link to Krishna. This is the basic message, and who am I? And then everything starts. And then if we just stick to the basics, and then all the other aspects are things which are events unfolding while we go along the passage. But this main route should not be deviated from. So that is actual intelligence. And we saw examples of Sukhdev Maharaj and Jad Bharat. And Suklamba Brahmachari was one who, in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela, very learned, but he was very humble and he used to go and beg. But people were, you know, laughing at him and thinking he was a fool. But actually, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you know, when he used to take those rice, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he acknowledged it by, he said, I only want that kind of rice, which was, though it was actually old rice. So we see the reciprocations, how Krishna rewarded, I mean, Krishna, by his words and action, really glorified the gopis. We can see from the eyes of the Shastra that who are the ones whom we need to emulate. So these are the signals that we get. Gopal Bhatt Goswami, he imagined when Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami was instructed to write the whole Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela, knowing that he's writing about the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and that this is going to be, when we talk of history, we still put a timeline. This is timeless. I mean, it is going to go through not just centuries but eons. So imagine if when Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami went around with all the Goswamis and actually said, I need your blessings. If you were asked to be part of such an event that where your name would be in the books forever, so Gopal Goswami said, my blessings are there only on condition that there should be no mention of my name anywhere, anywhere at all. So there is no mention about him, though he was one of the principal six Goswamis whom Chaitanya Mahaprabhu directly instructed. So this is the kind of humility. So it doesn't signify that he was, you know, he was the most self-realized, but at the same time understood the essence, and he felt that this was completely unnecessary. It could be an obstacle. Same with Rupa and Sanatan Goswami. When this Rupa Narayan, one very learned pundit, came, very arrogant, a brilliant debater, and he had defeated everyone else in the land, and he came and challenged them because he was told that if you defeat them, then you'll be able to declare. And he used to, whoever he defeated, he would get them to sign that, yes, I lost to you on a debate. So he, this Vijay Patra, and then he would go and go to the other persons. And so he had defeated many others. When he came to Rupa and Sanatan Goswami, he challenged them. So Rupa and Sanatan Goswami, there was no comparison in terms of realization and understanding, but they were not bothered with this kind of mundane competitiveness. And so they said, okay, you are claiming you're the greatest, fine. They think, oh, you think I'm the greatest? Yes, I don't want to debate you. So then he was so happy, he really took it. He thought that I'm so strong, and they feel they're so weak that they are cowards, that they have agreed. So he said, okay, then sign here. So Rupa and Sanatan Goswami actually signed, saying that, yes, we agree that, you know, you are the best debater, and so on. And then he very proudly went around showing. Then, of course, the nephew Jeev Goswami was, when he read it, he was outraged because he understood that this was the humility. They didn't want to bother about this, but how could he go about doing this, or Rupa Narayan? So then he smashed Rupa Narayan completely. And you know, but then Rupa Goswami was so upset at Jeev Goswami that, why did you have to do this? You know, I mean, so then he actually, that's another story when he actually he rebuked him. his nephew, and then he also penalized them, kind of, and then he accepted it very humbly. So that's taking us to another level. But the point is that great souls, they're not worried about how perceptions, how people think that whether they're supposed to be learned or not. So whatever they have understood and they're putting into their lives, incidentally, they are actually, I mean, they are perfect, and therefore they're being recognized all over, but it just is like water off the duck's back for them. Same with Prabhupada, you know, we now see his glories, but when he started in 26 Second Avenue, he was only serving the initial hippies who came. They barely understood his philosophy, but he was cooking for them, he was serving them, washing their plates, nothing, that he was happy. He even wrote to his godbrothers here, saying that, why don't you come? He was not looking after position. He just wanted to transform people's hearts and follow his Guru Maharaj's instructions. So he wrote to his Guru Maharaj, his godbrothers, that, why don't you come? You become the president of the society, and I'll just preach. I can be, So he was not concerned about, he never put his name. And so his mood was only that how the suffering souls can benefit. So, in the end, I'd just like to summarize by saying that, and one more thing, that when we were saying that when we come to the temple, we don't see we can't see from our eyes. We have to act in such a way that Krishna can see. Because even the demons in Vrindavan, Putna and Shaktasur and so many others, they came face to face with Krishna. They actually had physical battles with Krishna. So they should have got the highest benefit. They did in one way, but they didn't recognize it. So primarily, it's this. The message is that what we sing every day in the morning, in the prayers to the glorious or the spiritual master, yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, that only by the invoking, only by pleasing the spiritual master, Krishna is pleased, and Krishna, he will take us to Krishna. So our activities should be focused only on seeing what we can do to please the devotees, and they are pleased, and we don't have to show them. It's not that. It is just that, and we know what pleases them. They want us to sincerely follow our practices. Again, no need to demonstrate it, but just following it, whether we are doing it in our temple, whether we are doing it at our home, in association of devotees or not. It's better to be in association, but if whatever the situation, there's the flexibility that we can do it. So somehow, if we take the example of Queen Kunti and see that how, in spite of the highest success, when she had the maximum sufferings, she was always with Krishna. But she missed Krishna the most when she actually had the highest success, and that time her prayers were really that, because she was so sad to see Krishna go. She was not concerned about becoming the queen mother of the entire world. Her worry was that Krishna is going to Dwarka. So if we can develop that, how we could, in spite of the external successes or failures, then we would really, achieve the goal, which is invoking the mercy, and which that mercy comes only according to our sincerity of purpose. So the purpose has to be very critical. We have to question that, and it's very subtle. Sometimes we ask devotees, we say that, please pray for me. Now, are we saying that, please pray for me? Is it that we want them to, because we know that is a sincere devotee or she's very sincere, and that his or her prayers will make my task easier because I don't have to do much, is that the motive, or are we saying that, please pray that Krishna can, give me the strength to face up to my challenges. Because I have to do what I have to do. But I can take their prayers to, they can pray for my spiritual sustenance. So there are small, many, many subtle things that we have to always see whether, what is our motive? When we are doing any activity, what is it like when we are giving a class, or when we are preaching, when we are going out distributing books, when we are addressing the deities, when we are, whatever services we are doing, is there a subtle motive of being recognized and appreciated? or is it so what are the what could be the motives? So that's what we really need to worry about. The gross control is easier. The subtle challenges are ones which we all need to see, and that's really what Prabhupada says, that sincerity of purpose is what really attracts Krishna. So we'll stop here, and Hare Krishna. All the best, Prabhupada. Announcement. I have to make. Okay, there's an announcement. This is